Maison en Objet is a business show. It's B2B. It's twice a year in Paris. So as Nancy said, it's in September and in January. It's everything for decoration. And we also say it's a lifestyle show. We have like 45% of the exhibitors from around the world. It's not just about France or Europe. You will see products from quite everywhere. It's quite a big show. Actually, it's the main show, one of the main show in Europe, definitely the main show in France. We gather together 1,500 people visiting the show. And in those visitors, there are more like, you have like 35% of interior designers and architects. And the other parts are more retail, importer, wholesale, and showrooms holder. It's also a very mediatic show. We have like a lot of journalists from everywhere. 35% of journalists are coming around the world. It's 6,400 journalists coming every year in Paris. As the show is very big, they try to organize it in three different worlds. We have almost half of the show is about the house. A big hall, it's just about objects, maybe more than one hall, a hall and a half. And there is another part of the show about influences. So just to go a little more in detail, about the object, they just reorganized this show because it's a big, big, very dense show. They divide it in three different universe: cook and share, home and fashion, and smart gifts. It's more about lifestyle products. So that's the main part of the show. It's half of the show, actually. It's everything you need for decoration. It's furniture, it's home accessories, it's lighting, cushion, carpets. It's for showroom, retailer, importers. We have the big show, bigger hall about objects. And the influence part, it's a space created thinking more for interior designers or for journalists. It's a place where you will see like materials and you will see a very unique product. It's the part of the show when you can have a special inspiration, special influence. So Maison en Objet is not just about products. There's a lot of events during the show. Every year we have a designer. For this year it's Tristan Orr, but we had like Tom Dixon that he came last year in Vancouver. We had Ice Crawford also from England. So it's a parrain, it's a special guest, and he has a special area in the show with an exhibition. Twice a year, we also have a group of rising talents designers. Victoria was part of this program 3 years ago. Every January, it's a French group, but in every September, it's a group from another country. So it could be from Brazil. We had a group from Scandinavia. This September it's going to be UK, next year it's going to be Italia. So I wish we have a group from Canada, of course. I'm working on this with the team in Paris, and I hope we could do a special rising talent from Canada. During the September's edition, we also have the Paris Design Week in Paris. It's a very special week where you have like more than 200 places, design places in Paris, who are organizing a special event to make this the city very attractive for the design community around the world. And it's exactly during Maison en Objet. So coming in September, it's a quite rich period for design in Paris. As you see, you have a Maison en Objet from the 8th to the 12th, and all the day before and after, all the week, you have events for the Paris Design Week. Maison and Objet is also in charge of the Paris Design Week, and they organize like a special tour. You have like thematic tours in Paris when you can visit design place. I think they organize like five different tours in Paris, so it's very attractive for designers to be there at this time of the year. During these 5 days of show, you can work, of course. There is the designer studio when you can schedule some meetings. For the retail, you have a special area with exhibition. You have workshops about retail strategies to grab some ideas about this special activity. And this is the information desk, actually. Matériothèque, it's a very popular, very appreciated area in the show. It's a place where you see all the innovation about material. It used to be at the show always, but they moved it in Paris for the last couple editions. But it was missing strongly. The visitors really missed this part of the show. So it's coming back at Villepinte, so the place where the show is taking place, and you can find many ideas and speak with a specialist of material. So it's very appreciated for in architects and interior designers. Of course, a lot of conference. We have like five big conference, one every day. In January, for example, I attend a conference about silence in design. That was very, very special, very interesting. MOM, you saw this on the video. MOM is a new platform, digital platform created like 1 year ago by Maison and Objet. It's a free platform, so I invite you to open an account there, a profile, and you have access to the exhibitors of the show. You can consult their catalogs, and some of them provide prices and many information, technical information about the product. So it's a very good way when you visit the show to prepare it before, and of course to keep in touch with anybody you meet there all during the year. So this is the next edition. It's from 8 to 12 September in Paris. The same week as Paris Design Week, and the January edition will be from 19 to 23. So as Nancy said, you have in your red bag some discount coupon for air tickets, Air France tickets. So it's a 75 discount, dollar discount. So I wish you will use this ticket to visit us in September, and you also have free badge access to the show. So. Maybe you should register quite soon, because I think Maison and Objet gave the code for a few weeks. So just check the valid date on your coupon. And I'll be there all the evening. So if you have any question about the show, I'll be pleased to inform you. Thank you. And I leave the space to Victoria.
So thank you to Nancy to welcome me tonight. So I will speak a bit about. My work and where I come from. And so I'm a designer, and I graduated like in 2008 from London RCA, but it will be actually And first I did a BA in Camondo. It's an interior design school. And when I came back to Paris, I started to work by myself, and I set up my studio. And a few years later, I have found a nice place near the river in Paris, and I have built this factory. So we'll see some picture. So you can see the front window of it with my scooter, and and so you will see some more things after. So 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 yeah, I'm talking about the influence of the industry in my work in general, not only in the architecture of the space, but you will understand what actually inspire me. So when I'm talking about the industrial influence, it's also like how I had to manage how to bring all the machines downstairs in the workshop. And first, when I came to this space, it was only like a hole here, so I had to build the stairs and find a way to do like a kind of elevator, like not elevator, but how to say, I don't know the word in English. It's like a mini crane. And so this is the ground floor with the office, and later we'll see down there. So I've used some concrete panels on the wall, and you will see later I've designed some panels for this company as well. So it's like basically like BE13, I don't know how to say, like it's like a plaster panel, but it's in concrete. So we are downstairs already. So I have a little showroom with some products. And later we'll see some more of them. So the picture before was more than 1 year ago, and this picture was 1 week ago. So we have more projects. So there is like things that we are making actually in the space, like this kind of lamps here. So we see the machine later, like folding machines. And some stone projects like here, and this are made in factories outside, like in Italy or Portugal. These stools, we make there. And it's a mix of things that I'm making also with a manufacturer. But the specificity of the space is that we can make things. And mostly like metals. So this is the other part of the workshop. I mean, just behind the small showroom. So we have a few machines to do actually the basics in the making of the prototypes. So we have a little folding machines, like the welding post. This is a lathe. I don't know how you say lathe. This I don't remember the name. A drill, like a saw, a bending saw, and some others. So yeah, when we bought the machine, I wanted to really make a unique atmosphere, and I decided to have a color code and to keep it on yellow and black. So yeah.
That's a reference to the fact that we're driving around in our fantastic smart car that is
So we have to cut a logo tonight. So yeah, you recognize, maybe. Yes, this was 1 year ago, so it was clean, but it's still very clean. Because we clean every day after we work. Sorry. Some details. It's basically what influenced me. It's really like the tools. It's really like my work comes from that, actually. Like looking to the beauty of the tools, and because they are really beautiful objects, but we don't know that. But nobody really notice them, actually. So this is a very old project, like my graduation project, but I'm still actually today working on it for a French manufacturer, porcelain manufacturer. This was one of my first projects actually for an exhibition in Brussels. Pierre Berger Associé, it's an auction house. And it was actually my one of my first projects in marble, because something that I'm really using in my work, like marble is something that you will see again. This is a box actually made of petit granit belge, it's a stone, and enameled metal. It's not paint, it's like on the porcelain, the enamel. And this is a project I made actually in 2012 for Maison Objet. It's the entrance of one of the main hall. They asked me to do the scenography, and I decided to work actually on the, again on the influence of the industry, like the parking for trucks. Like you usually have those kind of plastic bands to protect the parking when the trucks arrive to uncharge. How do you say to unload? Yeah, unload the boxes or. This is a project made of resin, so it's really like a kind of aléatoire work. I don't know how to say aléatoire, but random, yeah. So the resin, it's you don't see it, but it's there are small tables, and actually the mixing of the resin creates these really random shapes, and actually quite natural. Kind of, I called it like biological marble tables. This was an experiment for Legrand, which is a very important brand of electrical devices, not devices, but they are making plugs, switches, and more quite classical, but they asked me for, actually it was not Design Week, but they call it Designer's Day in Paris. It's a week as well, where there is events in showrooms, and Legrand, they have a showroom. And they wanted me to experiment around new type of switches and plugs, and I designed several ones. Inspired again by the very industrial ones used like for factories and so on this one, for example, I kept the hidden part of the switch that you normally put like a cover on it, and you see the screws. This is something I made for a French editor called Coédition. It's glass table. These are plates made of stainless steel, and you will see, and you have seen before, some others, and a big mirror actually coming there. It's like a 1.40 meter mirror, and there is a steel plate and three magnets on the wall, and you just come and magnet it, and it's folded outside. Sometimes we imagine it's folded like that, but it's like that. Yeah, it's another subject, like I've made for an industrial working it's Corian, but the generic word is solid surface, yeah. I made a collection for him. And so basin. So another subject again. Yeah, I don't know if you know Taiping, it's a Chinese brand actually. I've designed a carpet. influenced by the spread metal. Alors, this is a part of a collection I've designed for a stone manufacturer, and he asked me to work with a Burgundy stone, which is very famous in France, and not really contemporary, in the contemporary way, more like in old buildings. And and the brief was to make a collection on the honeycomb process. So the honeycomb process is like 5 millimeters of stone on a layer of honeycomb, aluminium. It's what you have in the plane wheels, wings. So it makes it lighter and stronger, and you can have, you will see later, some other projects. So all the honeycomb is inside, you don't see it, it's made like a box actually. For example, the food are made of like four slices of stone and honeycomb, and it's closed and glued, but the inside is hollow. The same for this table, actually, made of statuario. It's an Italian marble from Carrara. And I've made actually a version of 6.50 meters, this one, in a synthetic stone actually. It's Sile stone. It's made of resin and stone, so it was also because of the wine process, because it's for a degustation, winery house. And I've also designed the spittoon wine. I don't know if this is a word, but another interesting subject. And actually, like the foot was made of stone as well, but you don't see it. But it's very, very long. It's like 6.50 meters. This is a collection I made for a gallery in Paris called Tori. Actually, I didn't write it, but. For the PAD. The PAD is a fair in the middle of Paris, in the Tuileries Gardens. It's also in London. And it's a nice fair with a lot of galleries, like contemporary, also more vintage, and they have a very nice selection. And I did this collection made of lava stone. And the lava stone is like a sponge. It's really with a lot of holes inside, and when I saw the stone, I decided to try to fill it with some resin, and you will see some details now. So it creates these nice patterns. It reveals the patterns of the stone, actually. And the foot are made of metal very nicely. You don't see the weld. The welding is inside. These are some pieces we make in the factory, actually. And it's made with brass. It's amori, which is just there, that makes those nice objects. And the tops actually are in corian as well, and with patterns, so it's nice. This is a fireplace. I think you saw it in the first picture of the showroom. And I'm actually doing it in marble for a flat in Paris. It's made of corian, so it's more like for the chimneys that are not really used. In Paris, you can't really make fire, actually. It's not really allowed. So it's more like the object can use as a console. This is a collaboration with La Redoute. La Redoute is a, how do you say, not only online, but you could order like with catalogs. It's a very old, how to say, Yeah, but it was only like a virtual shop at the time, online and on catalogs, but for everything actually. But after they started to make furniture, and so it was an online series. Matière Grise is a French editor. I don't know if you know actually Matière Grise, no? From Lyon. And she's really only making metals, and I decided to work on this folded little table. So we presented it like in September for the first time.
If I may, what was the thing you did for Reduce?
Sorry?
What was the product you did for
Reduce? Ah, this one, sorry. Yeah, I thought it was a kind of... Classer holder, I don't know how to say, like office files, yeah, holders. It's a box actually, container. Or you could even have it in your home and put shoes, I don't know, and you can stack it. And like containers. Sorry, it was not really obvious. So maybe you saw one of these little tables in the window here. It's a collaboration I made with Classicon. It was first showed in Cologne in 2016. So it's a small side table made of inox and glass. So the inox here is already colored when you work it. Actually, it's made in a bath, the treatment, finishing. And you have this very special reflection and color. This was in the offices of Classicon in Munich, and we were like trying the colors on the top, and this way it's not working. The blue shouldn't be there. There is too much. Sorry. And this is actually the new collaboration we did this year. It's a dining table made of as the same material, but it's a bigger structure. And we made as well a version of marble for the top. And it's a very new product that maybe you will see soon here. So these are the concrete panel I was talking about before. So I made this pattern for them that I called the factory, actually. So they are like 90 centimeters by 2 meters something. I can't remember the height. Well, 2.80 meters. So you can cut them, you can put them in every place you want. And this is a collection I made last year in stone, actually, again, with honeycomb. But the stone is Pietra Serena, so it's an Italian stone. From Carrara again, and it looks a bit like concrete, but it's not. And the mirror, it's completely flat. You can imagine its volume, but it's completely flat. This is a collection of actually more like samples I made for a fair called Domotex in Hanover. And it's a flooring fair. We are mainly carpets. But I've been selected to do this. You can't see anything here, but to do this young talents were like six, and we were like asked to do some research about flooring for the future, actually. And I work with stone and resin, and actually how to use some kind of already seen pattern, like I don't know if you know this opus incertum. Usually it's like leftovers of stone that you put a bit of randomly, and then there is some cement around, or and yeah, the idea actually was to make like some big tiles, and you will see after the making. It's machined, and then you fill it with the resin. You see the making here. So it's still research, it's nothing. This is an interior project for a restaurant in Paris, in the 10th district, called Amer, where we did the lights, actually. All was made in the factory, and the tables, and the bar. Yeah, the lights are covered with a very special treatment called bichromatage. I don't know, bichromatage. So you have this nice reflection that you see also on the foot of the table here. And this is spread metal. So you can see the making also of the lights on the folding machine. And the welding. This is a recent collaboration with a gallery called the Carpenters Workshop Gallery that is in Paris, London, and New York. And I made I did it for the pad again this year. You will see later. I start with the making this time. So again, spreaded metal. So it's something that we make in the workshop mainly. And for you those lights are really common, but I saw them when I went to New York in October, and I sent them over in Paris, because we never see that in France, actually. But for you, it's maybe... So you don't see the light, but it's coming. So this is still the making. This is Corian. All the research. And the final result, I hope I won't disappoint you. It's coming. So this is lava stone again, but I decided to leave the holes this time. And the finition is bichromatage again. Sorry, I will find the word later.
What's the scale?
The scale, alors the neon is 70 long. So I think it's 80 centimeters. Yeah. And this one. This is the other one with the Corian base. And yeah, this was a very special Corian. With a glass, glass tube. Yeah, so yeah, you know those tube, no? Yeah, those neon. For us, it's really strange. Everybody thought I made the lights as well, because we only have the straight ones and the round one, but not the U shape. Ah ben voilà.
I was very curious about how you balance all the design work that you do with running the factory.
How you balance? You how mean, you okay. Actually, we do both together. It's really nourishing. You know, I have some project that I'm designing for editors. And in parallel, we develop some personal collection, and I hope one day it will become something. And sometimes it's very important because when I make like those tools, you see some personal research, and after like some people comes and say, "Oh, I want to have it in my collection." So it's actually it's like that for the moment. I'm not really selling them actually on the internet, or this personal connection is really for the moment in my showroom, and so it's still very, very small actually. I don't know if I reply to your question, maybe not.
Well, it's always a challenge to have the creative side and then the acumen for business.
Yeah.
It's a different mind.
Exactly. Yeah. Maybe I'm not so good in business for the moment, but it's coming.
I think you are.
This is what you...
Hi. Because the limestone is so porous, when you cut it, does it fragment? Or do you know what I mean? Like when you're cutting stone?
Mm-hmm.
Does it...
You are talking about the limestone or
the
lava stone?
The lava stone,
the
sorry,
lava
yes,
stone,
yeah.
So...
Because the lava stone has so many holes and
yeah,
it's so porous.
That's why
I've
put some resin.
Yeah. Oh, and it seals it?
Yeah, you see the...
It's my favorite, by the way.
So, yeah. this?
Yeah.
So
yeah,
it's completely...
the lights when you left it, when you didn't fill it with the resin, because there's so many holes in the material.
You prefer it when it's...
the raw?
Yeah.
No, I love both of them, but okay. I love the lava stone, yeah.
So no, it's not so porous, actually. You always put products on the stone. You put like hydrofuge, I don't know how to say. You put products. You mean you see through it? You don't see actually. The holes are not completely through. I mean, you have like 2 centimeter slice minimum. So the holes.
You don't find it hard to work with?
Ah no, but I'm not doing it myself. Huh? I'm not cutting it myself.
Yeah.
No, it's really nice to use those raw material like
it's
that
beautiful.
And to make them look nicer. I mean,
I love it.
Thank you.
Do you know how to use the folder and the welder and everything?
Not the welding post, but the other machines. Yeah.
Okay. Everything else, the drill press.
Yeah. I'm before I was I really liked doing it myself, but now, it's not. I'm not only. Yeah, I'm not working so much on the machines, but a bit.
Right. Any.
Hey, it's pretty awesome, pretty rad. My question is kind of, it's more a comment and seeing what your thoughts are on it. So it seems like with some of your stuff, it's really about respecting the material as it is.
Mm-hmm.
So in this way of talking about the tooling and being like, you know, appreciate the integrity of this object. And so I see that in the stretched metal, this kind of thing. And then there's this other side that seems to be about complete reinvention, almost like taking something and throwing it in the other direction, so you have to re-see things. So can you talk about that balance in your work between the integrity of things as they are and then re-seeing something? Is that a thing?
Like in what, for example, the reinvention,
the plugs.
Ah, the plugs.
Yeah. And then
for me, it's like your use of like really raw metal materials that seem so starkly industrial. And then the other part of it is really taking that industrial material and positioning it in a new place, right? So when we go into these, I don't know, maybe that's just me looking at it.
This?
For sure this one for me.
Yeah, actually, it's like what I was saying is to unobliged the raw material. And the raw material comes from the very basic industry, machines. And actually, it's some materials that you are not looking at. But for example, the spread metal, you have a lot in the streets. Like even here, I've seen a lot to protect like windows or... So actually, it's just like, I don't know how to say, but...
It's okay, I don't know how to ask the question either,
so... You understand?
I think maybe.
Or maybe I don't understand myself, but... I think it's showing... the best of very simple material.
Your work seems really elegant and really kind of sophisticated and exciting and new and brash, but also really kind of understated. It's got a really beautiful balance. And for me, that seems kind of Parisian, sort of French. Do you think that your work is, and the sort of work you do is partly to do with you being French and from Paris? Do you think there's something to that?
It's hard to describe when you are from the country, but I guess there is a nationality in France, maybe, yeah. You are always in France, but what you see what how you have been educated, and but I have also the British education, so I don't know. Maybe it's French. I don't know. It's hard to describe. Maybe you could tell it more than me. Yeah? The French. What is really French?
Where were you, and what was the context of the tube lighting in New York that really caught you?
Home Depot.
Oh, no way!
Actually, I want to go tomorrow as well. I've seen that you have some.
And you said it was the curve of the light that's not common, Paris, that you've seen the linear lights, but not...
We don't have it in France. You have it like in all the offices lighting, but for us, it's no.
You have Home Depot in France?
All?
You have Home Depot in France?
No. Home Depot, what is it? Ah, Home Depot, no, sorry.
No,
no, we don't have that.
No, they have the basement of the BHV, though.
Oh. Yeah, but BHV. Oh. But it's boring. No, it's nice. You see, you can find everything, but...
Not tubes like that, though.
Not tubes like that, but it's always more exotic to see, like, it's new tradition. I mean, you have different way of building, of making, of... you have different tools, and it's nice.
I like your lights better than Home Depot.
Yeah.
Are we... other questions, or...? Okay. Thank you.